Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to what is now, I believe, the 18th or 19th episode. I don't remember off the top of my head. It's one of those. But I'm your host, Jacob Bradley, and today I'm joined by a very special guest. You can already see her on your screen. She's clapping and flexing and all that stuff.
Yes.
Please welcome on Abbey Nettle. Abbey, how are you doing today?
I'm wonderful. A little tired, but that's because I'm up before 2 p.m. So
fair enough. I didn't realize I was making you get up before 2 p.m. here.
No, it's okay. I need the motivation to get up.
Yeah, I had to bring my brother to school this morning, so I've been up for a while. That was fun. I don't know how we ever did it, going to school at 7 o'clock in the morning.
That's like, because I never drove there in the morning. I made my brother do it because I would fall asleep behind the wheel and kill us.
Just terrible.
I know. That's a terrible scenario, isn't it?
I mean, I don't know about you, but my earliest college class this semester, well, I take that back. My earliest class was 10 this semester, but last semester for the fall, it was like 11:30. And I'm like, that's a dream. Like,
I couldn't.
No?
See, I didn't even attend my classes like at all ever.
Oh, okay.
No matter the time, I just didn't go.
Yeah. So. Fair enough. That's fair enough, I guess. But yeah. But why don't we kick well, hold on. Let's talk a little bit about because we are in the middle of May, and I would assume that you, much like all the other college students, have just experienced finals week. So what was that like?
You know, I'm only halfway through my finals because, again, like I said, I'm pretty lazy and I procrastinate. And, you know, my deadlines were a couple of days ago, but I just figured I'm going to submit them late because
why not?
I'm
going
to pull the mental illness card. Guys, I'm mentally ill. Accept it. But I'm halfway through. You know, it is a little tough when you don't go to class and don't know any of the material. It's fine. I just kind of like did what I had to do.
Yeah. Were they all online finals or did you have to go any in person?
No, all my classes were online, but I went to campus because I was like, I don't want to be home.
Yeah, that's fair enough. That's fair. But I have one more tomorrow in the morning. I have to go up to Oswego for that. 10:30. So yeah, that's all right. I mean, it'll be fine, but then I'm done and I can't wait.
Yes, summer.
Yeah. Do you have any big summer plans at all? I know we're starting to reopen things, and you're kind of an outgoer, and you like to do a lot of the party a lot of concerts and stuff. You got any plans for any concerts or anything?
I mean, most concerts that have been scheduled are like for actually like September.
Oh, okay.
So I'll probably be at school, but I don't know. Nothing's really sparked my interest yet.
Fair enough.
I'm waiting on that one.
But just any general plans yet that you know of?
My boyfriend's coming up like once a month.
Very nice.
That's exciting because he lives down near my school. So he's not in Syracuse, which is unfortunate. But
lucky him, right?
I know. I'm going to have to show him everything about Syracuse, the polluted lake, everything disgusting, you know.
But I'll tell you what, though, I was just talking to Ryan DeWan the other day, and he's kind of in the similar boat as you. He's got a girlfriend that's not from the Syracuse area. Yeah. And I was asking him, picking his brain a bit, what would you show him? What would you show your boyfriend up here in Syracuse?
Okay. I'm definitely okay. I would take him to Onondaga Lake, but that's pretty basic because that's in like Liverpool where we're from.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'm pretty terrified of driving downtown, but I do want to show him downtown.
Just walk. Take a bus.
That could be a little dangerous, but like that's a really good question because there's so much here. Like when you leave like and go as far as I did and then come back, you're like, wow, there's actually a ton of stuff to do here.
Yeah, I know. Take it for granted in a way.
I know. I'm like, there's a Chick-fil-A like 10 minutes away from me, and there's not one for hours where I'm from. Like,
I know. They I don't know if we're talking about the same one, but they just finished building the one in Liverpool. Yeah. That's literally like right around the corner from me.
Yes.
Like I can walk if I want. Don't have to do any more day trips to Cicero or anything.
Yeah, that's one I live near, actually. Like, I'm on the border of CNS.
So okay.
Kind of near all that stuff. Like, what's over there? Sonic.
Yeah, Tully's is over there. But...
tons of stuff. I'm like, yeah. Actually, I'm so... that's what I'm thinking about. Like, all the different restaurants I could bring him to. Like,
yeah,
I've already brought him to Tully's. So that was notable. The experience, like, the waiter was terrible, but I was like, listen, disregard, the tenders are good.
That's what he had, I would assume, right? Is the tenders?
Yes.
Just straight up, or any Asian or buffalo or anything?
Original. You have to do original the first time. Yeah,
you gotta lose the virginity card to Tully's with the straight up original, and then you could progress into some of the other flavors.
Absolutely. I agree. Yeah.
I used to go on a kick and get the Asian tenders, but now I've kind of dialed it back and just gone back to the original for the last couple of months. I mean, yeah. You can't go wrong. You just can't go wrong.
No, the Asian tenders, I feel like those are special occasion tender, you know?
Yeah.
You really have to be ravenously hungry for those.
Yeah, right, because you eat like three of them and then you're like, oh, I don't know if I want any more of these. But then you save them for dinner later and it's all full circle. Right.
Snack.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's all full circle. But all right. Ryan said pretty much the same thing. Like he you know, my suggestion is always the most. Go to the most. That's always really? My suggestion. I don't even know if it's open, but it's just fun.
The most?
The most. You got that big play pit. You can go, I don't know, find fossils. I'm only kidding. The mall is probably the answer, but I personally would, if I were to go on a date, I would want it to be as much fun for me as it would be for the next person. So kids museums are always up there.
I'm trying to think of something like thrilling, like I don't know, like jumping out of a plane into
the lake. I've never jumped out of a plane, so I have no stance on that,
but I would do it.
I might, but I hear that it's just, it could be, you either have a really good experience with it or not a very good experience with it. And I don't know where I'd stand.
Mm-hmm.
No, I don't like the escalator going up to the movie theater at the mall. So I don't know how much I would like the whole jumping off of a plane aspect.
You know what? That actually, yeah, you've made me realize that. Because I hate elevators so much.
Yeah, it's a very two-way street, isn't it? For when you put it in the perspective, but
never mind.
Yeah, just stick to someplace on the ground.
Yeah,
but but all right, as we move on here, as I had mentioned to you off camera, we do a thing here, the tell them about that Hall of Fame segment, and this is its triumphant return because it has not been around the last few weeks. Obviously, there was no podcast last week. But the weeks before have been some group podcasts. So I believe the last edition of it was probably a month ago or so. In podcast, like in the YouTube time, in my time, it's been a while. But so Abby, I got to ask you, what is your official induction into the Tell Them About That Hall of Fame?
I had to think about this for approximately 5 minutes. And I would say it's a person. I would like to induct Alex from the New Paltz Gulf Gas Station into the Hall of Fame because of how generous he is.
Oh yeah?
Yes.
What made him so generous? Can we talk about that on camera or do we have to talk about that off camera?
We can talk about that. I'll just say they have a great selection of beverages for college students.
Very nice. And he's
very much willing to give those out.
Okay. So tell us a little bit about Alex. Was he an older gentleman? Was he a peer? Was he younger?
He's like, there was one time on my birthday where I walked in with a purple wig on. I was like, hey, Alex, what's going on? I kind of asked him about himself. And he said, I think he was from Jordan, like the country Jordan.
Oh, wow.
I think he's like from a family of like immigrants.
Wow.
But he's like in his 20s. He has a very indicative style of the backwards baseball cap and a plaid overshirt. And everyone knows Alex. They go to the golf. They take pictures with him. It's like, Hey, we're with Alex. So shout out to Alex. I love
that's awesome.
Alex.
He's got to love his life, doesn't he?
He does. He's always blasting some like Romanian music in there.
That's I love awesome. It. I Living love the it. Dream, huh?
Absolutely.
Well, yes. We'll use that as a seamless transition into college life. So so New Paltz, right? That's where you attended.
Yes.
It's a smaller college, correct? It's a little bit small.
It's about the same size as like Ithaca.
Okay.
It's like medium small size, yeah.
Yeah. So yeah. So did you pretty much get along with just about everybody you met up there?
Oh yeah. Oh yes. I kind of made it my job to network the whole campus.
Oh.
So I really tried to know everyone there and be friends with everyone. I had my few little issue people.
But, that's going to happen.
Yeah, I put them in their place. They know not to mess with me, and they know not to mess with anyone else because I know everyone, meaning just by association, they're not going to be liked. So
yeah,
I guess I hold a lot of power in that sense. But yeah, I mean, I did meet a lot of people, great people.
We needed somebody like you up at Oswego to connect the campus because there was very little connection up there at the campus.
Oh my God. I'll be up there for like spring break. Oh no, no one will be there for spring break.
Yeah, don't come up to Oswego for spring break. Go somewhere nice.
Yes, yes. I will try to do something for you. I will.
That's all right. I'll have to take on your mold and go around and try to introduce people to each other. And hopefully I make a couple friends there.
Literally just like, I don't know.
Yeah.
Walk down the street and just like yell at people. I'm so serious.
I know, but you see, I don't have the balls, as we say, to do that. I don't think I have the confidence in me to not like, because if I get flipped off once, it's over. I'm just not gonna talk to anybody. I'm gonna be absent for 4 years.
Ooh, it's probably a much different atmosphere in Oswego too.
Yeah, I mean, it's very, you know, and I don't know. I don't want to stereotype or judge anybody that I haven't met, but it's very, you know, way college, yeah. Choke, all that stuff, you know, that's not really my game, but
no.
You know, oh well. But overall, let's get back to you because nobody cares about my college experience. We're all here to listen to you. How would you describe the overall environment at New Paltz?
Hippie.
Really?
Carefree, liberal, just very like progressive type of college town.
Nice.
Yeah, if you love anything hippie related, New Paltz is the place for you.
Really was that did you know that going in, or was this all a surprise to you?
I knew that New Paltz was known as the stoner SUNY school.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, you know what, that atmosphere could be really fun. I was like, yes, let me go there.
So yeah, and you just fit right in. I fit like a glove.
I fit right in. Right in. Yes.
Good stuff, man. But so you're up there. I mean, I know you mentioned earlier you didn't really go to class, but what are you up there studying? For those that don't know,
I am majoring in journalism. You know, hearkening back to both our days. In broadcast journalism, what was that? Yeah.
Yeah, awful.
Co-host the
what whatever. Was it, like once a month, we got ripped off, didn't we?
Yeah, whatever. We were.
I guarantee we're the only two students in that class that are currently studying anything to do with that class.
Yeah.
And we barely got on TV. It was awful.
No. So majoring in journalism, I'm minoring in Black studies,
okay.
And I'm trying to do a double major in PR, so public relations. I think I'm going to do that. So,
very yeah. Nice.
Thank you.
Yeah. So, what's the end goal with all that? Like, what are you trying to do when you go out in the real world, or do you not know yet?
Oh, I have a whole plan.
Okay.
I thought.
Let it rip. Let it rip.
You know, the big goal is to be like interviewer for Rolling Stone magazine.
Okay.
But literally, I will do anything in like the music industry that involves me like interviewing or writing. Or PR, like anything I can do to like promote or like talk about music, yeah. I will do. I love music, so I'll do that.
100%. Do you have any inspirations or anybody that made you want to do that? Or is this just something you came up with over time?
I literally think it's just something I came up with because I just loved concerts or going to concerts for so long. And there was always something in me was like, God, I wish I could talk to them. I want to talk to them. So I kind of just made my own little niche. I was like, this is what I want to do. I want to do music journalism, but whatever can get me there, I'll do. So
yeah, that's pretty dope. That's pretty dope. I know obviously not much came from the pandemic in the fall. At least I'm sure at Oswego nothing did, but I'm sure it probably was the same at New Paltz. But do they get like concerts up there every once in a while? Like do people show up and perform up at the campus?
Not necessarily at the campus, but in town there's a place called the Groovy Blueberry, which is like a venue, and then there's another venue called the Parlor, which like local bands play at. So like pretty much campus kids and whatever local people live in New Paltz, they play. So I've been to a couple of those concerts, which are pretty good.
Yeah.
Yes.
Did you interview any of the people there?
Did I? Yeah, I've been meaning to. Like, I talk to them in DM, and I talk to them, like, in person so often, but I never set up, like, an official interview.
Yeah.
So I do have to do that, but I do plan on doing that, like, next semester.
Okay.
Yes.
Will you do stuff on your own, kind of like I'm doing, or will you go through the campus and use some of their stuff?
Right now, the only things I'm doing through the school itself is I have a radio show now.
Oh.
Through my school, so it's like it's called WFNP radio, so it's like New Paltz students host their own radio shows for like an hour. So yeah. I'm doing that, and I want to join the magazine there. I think I would do that, but other than that, freelance.
Yeah, you know,
kind of what we're doing here.
But yeah,
yeah.
No, that was kind of my thing. Not much was open in the fall up at Oswego, so I was like, you know what? Let me fire up this old podcast here and start with interviewing some friends. And now that I'm kind of running out with friends, I'm going to have to start getting proactive like you and DMing some people. But that's I'm not as culturally diverse as you in the music industry. I don't know any of these up and coming people from New Paltz. So the only people I know are like the mainstream artists. So come on now, I'm not getting any of them out here.
Nah, it's very hard.
Oh, yeah.
I've tried that. Well, I don't mean to flex. I don't mean to flex at all.
Flex right off. Go for it.
But I don't know. I think I posted about it a lot, but senior year of high school, no, this must have been junior, end of junior, beginning of senior year of high school, I would go to like the Westcott Theater, which is in Syracuse on Westcott Street. And there would be artists there, like pretty like indie popular artists like Claro, Wallows. I think Lil TJ was supposed to play there, but then the pandemic happened. But I photographed Claro. I photographed Wallows. I was supposed to photograph Lil TJ, which I will never forgive the pandemic for, because that ruined it. I was like, that could have been my big break. You guys don't understand. But yeah, I've been doing that. So I kind of know how to talk to, like, I always go through like management.
So I've
kind of got the routine down of how to email these people and find out information. So
yeah, I use TikTok as my source. If I see somebody talented on there, I have a little note sheet on the side. I'm like, let me write them down just in case before they get big, just so that I could get them while they're still independent and I could, you know, talk directly to them. But I want to get into that whole, because I did check out your website that you have posted in your bio. And if you don't mind, I'll post the link in the description of the YouTube video, so anybody can go check out her great photography work. But and so there's also some great stories on there as well that you could check out. But but so how do you go about like getting in there? Because I would assume it's not just you show up with a camera and you sit in the crowd, because those are pretty nice looking shots.
Thank you. I mean, the first thing I ever did was I reached out to the management of Claro's opening act. So that was, it's a really weird name, Biba Doobie, but she's pretty popular now worldwide. So I reached out to her management and he was like, okay, I can get you on the, what was it? The press list. Like he could get me on the press list. So I showed up, basically they're like, yeah, you're under press. So there's like the barricade, and then there's the front of the barricade with that little space where all the photographers stand. So I was just standing there. I was the youngest one. I was like, I don't know what I'm doing, really. But I just did that. And for a while, I just kept doing it through the Westcott because they knew me. So like they kept just letting me do it. So that was pretty much the easiest option. But literally how I just see it is, if you like an artist, try and find their management's information and email the management and be like, hey, this is what I want to do. Is there any way I can photograph or interview? Let me know. And I would love to be like on the press thingy. But that's like just what I've been doing. Like I just email management, or sometimes like if the artist is low key enough, they'll answer you directly and they'll just let you do stuff. So actually I have a interview I did with a band like 2 weeks ago called The Giving Moon. And they're pretty niche for now, but I can feel them starting to get somewhere. So I did like this. I kind of did a Zoom interview with them, and I'm waiting to edit that because I'm very lazy once again. But I've got that in the works. So recently I've just been trying to like reach out to bands like I like, who are pretty small, and then go from there, because it's pretty easy. It's not too hard.
No, that's probably, I'm gonna have to start doing some exploring over the summer and checking out some things. And you might be getting a couple text messages from me, hey, who's coming up in music that I could DM. But I mean, that's pretty cool. But so what are you gonna do with this whole with the interview that you just did with this band? Do you have a YouTube channel that you're gonna be setting it up on, or are you gonna be posting on the website?
I think I'm just put it on my website, to be honest. Seems easiest. I'm sure I could do YouTube, but I don't know.
It's not that hard, to be honest. Yeah. I could do it. Anybody could do it.
I know. I just like having it all in one place. So probably my website, to be honest. But
yeah. But no, it is. I checked out some of your pictures. You got some stories. But let's talk about what I remember was when we had to do, what was it? Was it journalism in like our junior year, I think it was? We took it with, what was his name?
Oh, Savakul?
Savakul, yep.
Oh my God, were you in my class?
I think so. I had him, so I would assume you were in the same class. Yeah, because that's what the story has to do with. Remember we had to do the project. It was like journalism. Like you had to go interview somebody for like the paper or whatever. You did a whole feature story, didn't you? On something going on at the, what was it, American High?
Yeah, I did do that.
Oh, yeah. How'd you go about doing that? How'd you go about getting in with the guys at American High?
How did I do that?
Yeah, we're going like 2-3 years back now.
Okay, I'm gonna say what I think happened. It could be slightly wrong, but I think this is what happened. So when they filmed the Big Time Adolescence with like Pete Davidson, remember when that came here?
Yeah, I do remember.
I noticed Pete Davidson had a photographer named Marcus Russell Price, and I followed him, and I was like, hey, you're in Cuse. What's going on? Like, and he kind of filled me in. I was like, oh, cool. Me and Marcus Russell Price are kind of like low-key friends now. Like, we DM all the time.
Nice.
He's verified on Instagram now.
Wow. Look at
Pete
that.
Pete Davidson's photographer, so I'm like, I think helped me get like a phone number for them,
okay,
for like the company, because I didn't know how to reach out. So he got me a phone number, and I basically called and was like, hey, I'm looking to talk to, I mean, the head honcho over there, his name is Jeremy Gerlich, and he basically runs like all the production. He's like, I think he helped direct or produce like the, is it The Wedding Ringer with like Kevin Hart or something?
Probably. I don't know. I personally not familiar with him, but I know the movie you're talking about.
Yeah, I think he helped do that. So I was like, okay, he knows some stuff. So I think I honestly just called them and we set up an interview. And then I remember I wanted to follow up in person with another one of their like associate producers. His name was Michael. And then he's like, hey, come down to American High. You can come take some pictures of that inside and I'll show you around. They're like, okay, cool. And then I show up and they end up filming like a whole different movie right then and there. And I don't know if anyone is privy to this information, but Joey King. If you guys know from Disney Channel, the show Liv and Maddie, and there was that brother Joey on it with the glasses.
Okay.
He was doing that, and he was in Liverpool filming this, so I kind of got to talk to him. So I was, like, trying to write about one movie, but then I ended up being there talking to people about another movie. So it's just, like,
yeah.
I don't know. It was kind of just, like, luck, to be honest. It was just, like, luck of me being there at the right time.
Yeah. That's kind of what happens, isn't it? You're just there at the right time, and things start to work out.
Literally, yeah. It's very much not about planning, and it's just, like, spontaneous, so.
Yeah.
I was like, okay.
Nah, so this is completely different, but we, me and my dad specifically, we're not like you. We're like, we'll make sure they know that we're there. We'll, like, kind of keep our ears and eyes peeled, because I remember when that Big Time Adolescent movie came out, or was being filmed, it was Pete Davidson, and was it Machine Gun Kelly in it too? Yeah. I don't know if he was ever in Syracuse, but I don't.
No, he was. Yeah.
Oh, he was. Okay.
Yeah.
But either way, we were trying to meet up with Pete Davidson because we like Saturday Night Live.
Yes.
And we were like, you know, and he was, I believe at the time he was dating Ariana Grande too.
Yeah.
So like that would have just been a bonus. And like people had seen her at like the mall and stuff. Mm-hmm. So we were like, let's keep our ears peeled. And my dad's got a couple, we'll call them connections, but they're a little bit shady. They're a little shady. But so we were going to, you know, we heard, okay, they're filming at you know, obviously that American High was the main base, but it'd be like, okay, they're filming over by the Christmas tree shops. So then like we go over there for a little bit, wait out for like an hour, and then nobody shows up. So we'd split. And what happened one time was I went to a baseball workout in the morning for one of the summer things. And our coach Cherzini wasn't there. He and we were like, where's Coach T? And he was like, well, he's doing this movie at Nottingham High School. With, you know, him and like the state championship team were filming in as extras, like, in one of the scenes where they play baseball. And I remember going home, I'm like, Dad, they're at Nottingham High School, like you know, that's where we need to go. So we went over to Nottingham High School and just hung out there at the baseball field for a little bit. And Pete Davidson, and I don't want to like spread false information, but he must have been high off of his you know what, because him and a couple of the co-hosts were on this golf cart. And they were just going as fast as they can around the track down down at Nottingham. So me and my dad and my brother was with us, and we were sitting there hanging out. And here he comes. And I was like, you know, hey, Pete Davidson, can we like snag a picture real quick? And he was like the nicest guy ever. Like he was super cool. So I have a picture with him. But like we've done that with a few people like that. I haven't gotten any interviews, which, you know, probably would have been more beneficial.
Hold up. Backtrack. You have a picture with Pete Davidson?
I do. You want me to pull it up?
Yes, I want to see it.
All right, hold on a minute. Now. Let me find it.
You have no idea.
It's, I'm all like clean shaven and shaved head. Like this is a while ago. Let's see if I can find it real quick. I'm on the clock too. I'm pressured, so it might take me a bit.
No, that's like so. That is literally the epitome of like everything I try to do is like get pictures with people.
Oh, a little bit of a glare. But there's he's in the blue. It's not really focusing. And then whoever his co-host is the other guy. But yeah, we've done that for a few people. Like it's some people call it creepy. Me and my dad call it strategic. But but yeah, we just, you know, we keep our ears peeled. And for the most part, like it wasn't like they were keeping it a secret. Like they were putting it all over Syracuse.com and stuff. Obviously you knew about it. So it was like everybody knew about it. But But yeah, we've done that a few times, had to kind of get a little weird stalker like, but it's okay. We're young, or we don't mean anything by it. These other dudes are like 45, so they can, you know.
You're not like paparazzi, so.
No, we just want to see them, get to take a picture and all that. And it was actually a pretty cool day because it literally was like a good 2 weeks of buildup that we were like, we want to meet this guy. And to the point where me and my dad went to that American High.
Yeah.
And Pete Davidson was doing a on the spot stand up routine or something like that. And he posted it on like his Instagram or something. So me and my dad went, and it was all right. It was pretty good. For the most part, it was like, you know, all off the cusp stuff that he would come up with. It was very low key, but we went and he was good. And, you know, we still didn't meet him there. And we were like, damn, like that might've been our last shot. And then it just all happened to be that, you know, if the Liverpool baseball team wasn't at that thing, probably don't know. So same thing. It's just being in the right spot at the right time, really.
Yes, absolutely. That's so exciting.
We haven't been able to do that in a while though, because of the whole pandemic thing. Because nobody's been around lately. But who knows? Maybe the fair will get some people this year.
If you know, let me know, because we can go together.
I will. Absolutely. Yes, if there's any big stars, I'll be texting you right away. Hey, bring your camera. Such and such is coming.
Yes, I'm ready.
But all right, let's move along here. And there's one final thing that I wanted to talk about here before we let you go. And it's a little bit on a more serious note. So about a year ago was the height of was when George Floyd was murdered. I know we just went super dark right there, but he was murdered by the police officer. And you on social media were one of the most vocal people that I had personally followed. You went out and made a few posts that I don't want to say gained clout, because that's not what you were in it for, obviously. But a lot of people were reposting it and stuff. And then also you came out with a very touching and inspiring video sharing your feelings and opinions on it. I just want to ask you, like, what? Obviously, I can answer this for you, why you did it originally, but what was your inspiration for it, and why did you really decide, I want to take a stand and make my voice heard during such a pivotal time?
I guess it was me noticing a lot of inaction, not necessarily by, you know, the communities that were affected, but like within Liverpool, no one was really advocating for it. And, you know, me having a lot of friends, like a lot of my friends happen to be like Black or POC. And so I was like, I'm sitting here as a white woman doing nothing, and I'm seeing all these other white kids from Liverpool do nothing, say nothing. So I'm like, and I've noticed like a lot of like back in high school, like I always like had little micro issues with people, like not outright, but I don't know. I think definitely the pandemic made me more like bold, or made me more extroverted.
Yeah.
Surprisingly, because then I became more outspoken, and I would just see like some people like at our school have like little racist tendencies, or like kind of be just like not it. Like they would start stuff, and I'm like, listen, someone needs to put them in their place. Even if they don't like it. Cause I did get a lot of backlash from people who didn't like what I posted.
I know.
But like at the end of the day, like I wanted to speak on it, not for like myself, but for my friends who, you know, kind of felt silenced by it, who were Black and POC. And I felt as though I wanted to use my white privilege and kind of put something out there. Cause I feel like I do have a good speaking voice. So I was like, I will write something and I will speak on it, because I don't think this is fair, and I want to speak for my friends who definitely are more affected by this than me.
I personally thought you did a great job. I mean,
thank you.
From what I remember, and this is kind of off aside, that video that you did, right, was that all in one take?
Yeah.
So like you sat down, did you do it once, or you had to do it a few times?
I like wrote a little script, so like everything I wanted to say, but I didn't like edit it or take breaks or anything. Like I just ran through it.
That's the best way to do it. I mean, you see, and this is a completely different thing, but you see all these like BS people on social media and on YouTube, they do something wrong, let's put out an apology, and there's like 30 cuts, and it's like, you know, that's not genuine. Like genuine to me is just sitting down in front of a camera and speaking your heart, which I thought you did beautifully around that time. But yeah, I could speak for sure that you gained a lot of respect on my end for doing that, because it takes, like I said earlier, it takes a lot of balls to do that, because you did. You got a lot of negative backlash from people that, at least I would at the time, probably have considered people that I was either friends with or acquaintances with. And like you said, once the pandemic hit and all that stuff kind of happened, you really started to see true colors of people.
Yeah, literally. I was like, wow. Like it honestly happened to be like, some people were even like my brother's friends. Yeah. So it's like, it's kind of hard, you know, having a twin who has these friends who have these sort of political beliefs, and I'm like, don't like them at all. Yeah. I'm like, okay. But like at the end of the day, like I didn't do it for me. I did it for my friends and, you know, people who kind of don't have a voice. And that's kind of like why I ended up going to, there was a organized, I want to say, was it protest? Like it was through Cuse Youth BLM.
Okay.
And it was basically organized by these two high school students from like the inner city schools, or Syracuse city schools. So I went to that, and it was a really good organization. We did a whole walk. I thought it was great. I thought it was a good turnout of, like, the Syracuse community, and especially for young people. Like, it was kind of strategized so that more young people would show up to it. So I really enjoyed that, and I wanted to do more of that. But it's kind of died down now, but, of course, there's more work to be done.
Absolutely.
So that's kind of why, like, I keep talking about it. Like, I'll keep posting stuff about it. Or when I see something, you know, of injustice, I'm going to, like, put it up and speak a little on it because, again, those stories don't deserve to be silenced.
Absolutely. So, absolutely. Yeah. And I know what you're thinking as the common viewer. What are these two white kids out here talking about issues like BLM for? But they need to be talked about. And I knew personally when I had asked you to do this, I was like, you know what, we should talk about this for at least 5 or so minutes and just, you know, discuss it a bit. But like you said, work is far from over. The conviction a couple weeks ago was a good step in the right direction.
Yes.
But so much more to be done still.
And I think it really, just like you said, kind of helps you realize, like, what people are really standing for and who you surround yourself with, and kind of just outed a lot of people for being
100%
terrible people.
Yep. And it really, like, I don't want to say it shocked, because in the end it really didn't. And you're like, yeah, okay, that's not surprising. But for my own personal amusement, reading, like, your comment sections during that time and just reading what, like, nonsense people were posting, and then reading, like, your clapbacks and some of the other people's clapbacks, gave me a night of entertainment. And I was like, this is all right. This is all right. And, you know, going through liking all the comments from you and everybody else, you know, preaching all that stuff. But
it's the reckoning.
Yeah. Reckoning. I was for it, man. I love that stuff. I love the little social media arguments. Just sit back and let the world burn in front of you. But
of course.
But either way, like we said, hopefully it's a step in the right direction. And from the two of us, I'm sure we'll have, you know, all of our brothers and sisters backs for as long as possible. So
absolutely, 100%.
Yeah. But moving quickly on here before I let you go, I got to ask you, we already touched upon your website that you could find all that great stuff on. Like I said, once again, if I got to keep saying this so I remind myself so I don't forget to post your link of it in the description of this. Do you have any other things that you might want to plug out? Like, possibly maybe a podcast or no?
I would love to do a podcast. That would be so exciting. But I'm trying to think. I don't really know. If you know me and are seeing this, I sell a lot of clothes. Hit me up if you have any interest in vintage fashion. Second, I will be putting out more music-related interviews, so of course, check out my website. I'll be posting that on my Instagram, too. I'm going to plug my Instagram.
It's @abbey.nettle,
just my name, nothing else. I did a little mini project, which I called the Friendly Project, which is me just taking pictures of my friends and doing little blurbs on them. I started that, didn't finish it, but I have a lot of stuff in the works, journalism related. But as long as you're supporting me and helping me promote my work, I love you.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yes. No, I also wanted to mention this too. I did your Instagram post, right? About, or just, you know, are usually just the same, like taking pictures of your friends, taking pictures of things that you see and find cool. It made me personally realize, like, damn, I don't have many pictures. So now my goal is for the summer is to be more like you. And every time I'm with a human being that I haven't seen in a while, I want to make sure I snap a picture. Or if I see something cool, take more pictures this summer. That's my goal.
Yes.
To do. And I'll 100% credit my inspiration to you. But go ahead right there. Yeah. But and I'm glad you plug stuff, because the last few weeks I've asked the same question and everybody's like, nah. And then I go ahead and plug like 8 things. So it always makes you feel like such an a-hole. But but I'll plug my stuff too. If you enjoyed the podcast, do all that stuff for YouTube and all the algorithm and all that crap, so we can maybe get this off the ground a bit. If you follow the podcast on Instagram, if you choose, @tell them about that. I have a TikTok that you can follow where you'll see little clip bits of all of the, maybe even this part, we might even throw the dancing in there. You'll see all the, the clip, it's 30 to 50 seconds or whatever of each podcast every Thursday. Should be Thursday. We'll see how I feel tonight. But and if you're on Spotify because you didn't want to look at our faces, I think you missed out this week. But you can go ahead and hit the follow button on Spotify or wherever you get your podcast from. They should all download automatically at around 10 o'clock. It's a bit shady, but every Thursday at 10 a.m. is when all the new podcasts come out. But either way, Abby, it's been a pleasure today. Thank you so much for coming on.
For having me. It's been so good talking to you after like so long.
Like over a year. Well over a year.
Literally just nuts. Over a year.
It's just nuts. It's like flew by and it's gone so slow in the same way. But
here we are. We're back.
Either way. Yeah, we're back. We're back in it. Back in it. Hopefully I'll have you on many more because I feel like we just cracked the surface here today. Hopefully you'll bring some more projects in here and all that stuff. But either way, once again, thank you so much for joining us here today. As for me, I've been Jacob Bradley, and this has been episode, I still haven't figured it out, whatever, 18 or 19 of Tell Me About That. Last time.